Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Farron Cousins sitting in for Mike Papantonio this week. Here's what's coming up on today's show. Just in time for the 2016 elections, Republicans are bringing social issues back to the forefront. But has America changed so much that we will no longer tolerate the GOP's culture wars? With student loan debt growing at an alarming rate, college students and progressives are fighting back against the industry that is robbing them of a decent life. We'll tell you how they're doing that. And the generic drugs that you're buying might actually be more dangerous than their name brand blockbuster counterparts, thanks to the FDA's foot dragging, and we'll bring you all those details. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, you've just stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
The FDA was supposed to issue new rules last year to make generic prescription drugs safer for American consumers. But so far, they failed to take any action, which is leaving patients at risk and drug makers with a get-out-of-jail-free card. Join me now to explain why this is happening is Howard Nations. So Howard, generic drugs have always kind of been, you know, differently regulated, I guess, than name-brand drugs. Recently, it's become more and more of a problem. Take us back to the start. You know, what exactly is going on here with the FDA and these generic drugs?
Well, Farron, this is a matter of the FDA rule that controls the labeling of prescription drugs. It's a strange dichotomy. Brand name drugs, if they learn of some defect or some difficulty with their product after it goes on the market, are required to go back to the FDA and change their label. Amazingly, generic drug manufacturers, if they learn of products difficulties with their product, cannot change their warning label. They can only change their warning label if the brand name, if the brand for which they're a generic, changes their label first. The obvious danger in this is that brands are only 15% of the marketplace. Generics are 85% of the marketplace. So when brand name drugs are replaced by generics, they lose their interest in warning. They just don't care anymore. So what you end up with, there are also 430 generics that have no brand name. So the bottom line on all this is that 85% of prescription drugs, the warnings are either absent or they may be totally inadequate.
So how did we even get to that point? I mean, why the separation? Why make generics different from name brands in that regard?
It makes no sense. Even the United States Supreme Court said it makes no sense. Common sense would dictate that you simply change the rule. But common sense is very uncommon in Washington these days. And as you know, common sense has been replaced by dollars and cents. And so the FDA does not favor the change. There's been pressure upon pressure upon pressure on them to change this, and they are stalling and stalling and stalling. It even went to the U.S. Supreme Court, who acknowledged what you said. Justice Thomas, in the Mensing decision, said, quote, "This dichotomy makes no sense." But he said it's not for us to change. It has to go back to either Congress or the FDA to change, which is absolutely wrong. The Supreme Court could have changed this if they wanted to. They continued to protect corporations as they always do. And then in 2013, they extended it to say it applies not only to warnings, but to design defects. So the bottom line is the FDA rule preempts state law.
And so especially when we have a lobby as powerful as the pharmaceutical industry, earlier this century, really, the pharmaceutical lobby, one of the strongest one out there. We've had several new ones come up and take their place, but the pharmaceutical lobby is still very strong. Obviously, they have tons of money. So it's in their best interest, I guess, really, to keep this law or this FDA rule in place, isn't it?
It absolutely is. And the current FDA, in the interest of the pharmaceutical industry, has delayed this for years. They've used every bureaucratic method they could think of. In the meantime, hundreds of thousands of claims, literally, have been thrown out of court. as a result of this these rulings I just told you about. Citizens are injured, can't sue. So just the message is beware of generic drugs and know what you're getting into. Let me give you an example, Farron. If you have twins who have exactly the same problem, they're given exactly the same drug. One of them is a brand name drug, the other is a generic version of the same drug. Both have severe injuries. The person with the brand name drug has a claim for damages, can sue and recover their damages. The twin with the generic drug has no claim whatsoever, so the taxpayer ends up picking up the bill for their health care.
Unbelievable. And we have this generic pharmaceutical association. They've actually done studies. They know exactly what it's going to cost them as a generic drug industry if we were to repeal this rule. I think it's, you know, close to $4 billion that they know they could be looking at in potential lawsuits if the FDA says, okay, you have to play by the same rules as the name brand drug manufacturers. I mean, what does that tell us that they've done these studies? They know the numbers. They know exactly what their liability is going to be, and they're still out there fighting. I mean, that's to me, that's a pretty big red flag.
Well, what the Generic Pharmaceutical Association is saying is we are currently getting away with $4 billion a year in damage to our customers, to our patients, and because we have this shield. But if you take away our shield, we're going to have to pay that $4 billion a year to the people that we're damaging. And that's a pretty big admission as far as I'm concerned.
I think part of the problem is that obviously with healthcare costs, they're just going, you know, higher and higher right now. And so a lot of people, you know, they do gravitate towards the generic drugs. Obviously, they're a lot cheaper. You even have some insurance plans where the patient doesn't get a choice. When they go in there to get a prescription filled, according to their insurance, if there's generic available, that is what is defaulted right to them. And they don't know. I mean, people assume it's just as safe. But as we clearly can see from here, Public Citizen has done some great work on this. That's nowhere near the case. I mean, there is no, you know, a generic is no more safer than a name brand, is it?
No. And the fact of the matter is, right now, there are hundreds of thousands of claims pending in pharmaceutical litigation all over the country because of damage done by bad drugs. It's a very huge problem in this country. But the only thing pending are against the brand name drugs because the pharmaceutical industry protects, the law protects the generic industry from being sued. Can you imagine the number of cases that would be there by people who are injured by generic drugs, except they're being barred right now? But Public Citizen, you mentioned, they've done excellent work on this. They proposed the new law. It's no new law. It's a simple rule change. It's two paragraphs. It's in 2013. They were joined by several other consumer groups. They had letters from Democratic senators supporting them. And the head of the health department at Public Citizen said that this is ultimately a significant safety threat to patients, which it is. It's one of the biggest public safety threats facing us today.
And, okay, so Public Citizen has said, look, all you have to do really is just change two short little paragraphs.
Right.
This is it. We're joined now by all these other consumer organizations. This is what you have to do to fix the problem. The FDA had said, I believe last year, that they were going to issue a new rule by the end of 2014.
Right.
And here we have just a couple weeks ago, still no rule. I believe it was the last week of March. Still no rule, and yet they're holding a public hearing saying, well, okay, let's get the public to come in, tell us what you think. And I don't think there's anyone out there listening to the story that wouldn't go to the FDA, you know, want to smack them on the forehead and say, rewrite this rule. This makes absolutely no sense. And that's the craziest part. So why are we still, you know, we're 4 months out now from when they were due to issue a new rule, if they were going to issue one. Why are they still dragging their feet on this? I mean, what's happening in there?
Last year in 2014, they said, well, we're not going to change it now because we don't want to change it until we get a new head of the FDA. So now their latest tactic is, well, we're going to hold public hearings. That's just simply another delaying tactic. And the people that are supporting the rule as it is, interesting. The House Appropriations Committee and House of Representatives said that it's a public health is threatened by having multiple labels for the same product. That's so incredibly stupid. That's stupid even for a Republican congressman. The reason is because Big Pharma, since 2009, has been the largest single contributor to the House of Representatives. The other proponents of the bill are in favor of the rule change, very significantly. State attorneys general favor the rule change. The reason? Because of a lot of that $4 billion that we're not collecting from the generic drug companies is falling back on the states. And state laws are also preempted by the FDA rule. So the states and taxpayers are picking up that $4 billion bill that the generics are being protected from paying.
That's actually worth hitting one last time, is that every single person watching this, that $4 billion that these generic drug makers are being shielded from having to pay is coming out of your pockets right now. You know, as everybody's just paid taxes. We're paying this. We're already paying this because of a simple rule change that our, you know, corporate-friendly FDA refuses to make. And that's the worst part. I mean, we saw plenty of times during the Bush years where you had members of industry moving into the FDA and members of the FDA moving out and directly into the pharmaceutical industry. I haven't followed it as closely under Obama, but I have to imagine that we're probably seeing a lot of the same things, especially with some of these holdovers from the Bush administration, is that we do have, you know, such a revolving door there with the industry and the FDA. Real quick, is there any way we can change that?
No. The FDA is a wholly owned subsidiary of Big Pharma, and it's not going to change. And it won't change because of bureaucracy in Washington. The head of Health and Human Service, Kathleen Sebelius, was very, very much in favor of this change. She pushed for this change. Theoretically, the FDA is under Health and Human Services. Theoretically, she's the Secretary of Health and Human Services. They were under her. She pushed hard for this change. They delayed her, and they delayed the public citizen. They've delayed every consumer group. They've delayed the Democrats in the United States Senate that favor it. They keep delaying and delaying because they are the wholly owned subsidiary of the FDA. They take care of those just because of that revolving door that you talk about. FDA people today are looking forward to retiring from the FDA and going to work for Big Pharma for big, big, big bucks. And it's really one of the best investments the pharmaceutical industry's ever made, was buying the FDA.
Absolutely. It's completely unbelievable that they're still just dragging their feet on this issue. But Howard, that's why we've got people like you out there fighting for consumers every day. And thank you so much for telling us the story this week.
My pleasure, friend.
Indiana Governor Mike Pence has set the nation on the path all the way back to the 1800s with his recently signed Religious Freedom Bill. That bill has given businesses the ability to discriminate against others based solely on that particular business's religious beliefs. And now a host of other states are following suit with their own interpretations of religious discrimination bills. And I have Matt Filipowicz, host of the Matthew Filipowicz Show, with me to explain what's happening. Matt, the best way to start this whole conversation about Indiana is just to simply ask you, what in the hell is wrong with the state of Indiana?
Well, Farron, I think what's important to know is that Indiana Republicans are leaders. They are leaders in intolerance. They are leaders in hate. I mean, prior to this bill, Jan Brewer down in Arizona actually vetoed a similar bill. And if you know anything about Jan Brewer, you know that she hates everybody, especially brown people. So when even Jan Brewer knows that a bill like this is a horrible idea, you know you're in trouble. And yet still, people, the Republicans in Indiana are like, all right, let's do this. We're all in. What Republicans are wanting to do down in Indiana is actually prove that they put the in intolerance.
You know, Jan Brewer is essentially the Ann Coulter of American governors. if she can hate it, she absolutely will. And so now, you know, Indiana says, look, maybe Jan Brewer can't hate this, but we can certainly hate, you know, homosexuals, just because, hey, we're going to cover it in religion. Yeah. We're going to say that it's all because of the Bible. The Bible says this is bad. Well, I don't know if they've ever actually read the Old Testament, or probably not even the New Testament. But shellfish, according to the Old Testament, is mentioned more as an abomination than homosexuality.
So mixed fabrics as well. You can't wear mixed fabrics in the Bible. And again, the Bible has been used to do so many things. The Bible has been used to justify slavery. The Bible has been used to justify bans on interracial marriages. What they want to do is Indiana is actually bring those classic arguments back. It's like, oh, those arguments. You know what? Let's bring those back. Let's talk about them more. I actually do have a couple of other theories on why Indiana actually went through this. You want to hear them, Farron?
Absolutely.
All right, so my first theory on this, Farron, is actually tourism. Okay, and while initially true, this did actually backfire on Indiana when several conventions announced that they were pulling out after this bill was announced. Indiana Republicans, again, their leaders, they're thinking big picture here. What Indiana Republicans wanted to do is they wanted to make their state the destination for America's hate-filled homophobes. I mean, like, so right, look at this now. Right now, pretty much everywhere in America, you know, marriage equality is moving forward. I think it's like 37 states now have same-sex marriage. Most likely it's the Supreme Court's going to rule for equality this term. Indiana Republicans were looking for a way to distinguish themselves. I mean, right now, what is Indiana known for? Like a car race or something like that? You know, that's clearly not enough. We need to figure out how to boost tourism. So sure, they lost a few conventions here or there, but they thought they could make up for that by catering to the more refined bigot. So think about this though, Farron. Where are homophobes supposed to go on vacation? What, they're supposed to go somewhere where everyone is treated equally and there's no discrimination when you purchase goods or services? Of course they don't want to go there. That's boring. That's a nightmare. No, homophobes want to go somewhere that they can feel comfortable, a place where they can be the intolerant backwards rubes that they are. You know, Indiana Republicans thought, why not Indiana? Why not us? We can make our state the Orlando of narrow-mindedness.
I just can't wait to see the amusement parks that will spring up that are themed to this. The bigot roller coaster. Hey, you know, there you go. Idea for you, Indiana.
The bigot roller coaster that just goes down and down and down and down.
It travels you back in time about 3,000 years, actually, is what it will do, too.
Right.
But, you know, this the way I see what's happening here, because we have Arkansas following suit. We have Louisiana that says, hey, we're going to do one even worse than what Indiana has done. And you already have 20 states that have some form of religious freedom bill. I think one of the reasons we're starting to see this is it's all about the timing, because we have Ted Cruz out there. He's the crazy nut Tea Party. I'm going to get all the fringe vote. Well, how do you drum up even more of the fringe? How do you take a moderate Republican and make them Ted Cruz crazy? You go back to the culture wars, and I think that's what we're seeing. I don't think this timing is necessarily coincidence. I really do see this as part of let's drum up that base that hasn't been active since Bush first ran in 2000, 2004. You know, it's that religious, you know, nutty group that they're pandering to. I think that could be a big part of this.
Well, what's really interesting about that, and I think you're actually correct, but what's interesting what happened in Indiana is, and I love when this happens, it's one of my favorite thing in politics when this happens, is when you actually had the religious right ending up butting heads with the corporate right. Because obviously the Republicans in Indiana were all for this. They were all, okay, let's do this. And even like you said, Arkansas was going forward with this. Georgia was going forward with this. But then what happened is the capitalists in the Republican are like, oh my God, we're losing business. This is actually hurting our pocketbooks when you had all these businesses saying, oh, we're going to pull out of Indiana. We're not going to expand in Indiana. And then you actually had Indiana go, hold on a second. Okay, we'll actually change the law to make it not so obvious. But I have my other theory on what Indiana was thinking here. And that the theory was they were going to try to boost business. So, and again, that sort of backfired. We had Salesforce saying they're going to stop their expansion. We had Apple coming out against it. So many businesses coming out against this. But again, Indiana Republicans, being the geniuses that they are thinking big picture here, Farron. They're hoping to attract a new kind of business, the kind of business that, again, hates and discriminates against gay people. people. They're hoping maybe we can get, oh, I don't know, the homophobes from Duck Dynasty. Maybe they can relocate to Indiana. That'd be wonderful, right? Or what about Hobby Lobby? You know, the Obamacare religious lawsuit works so well for them. Let's have Hobby Lobby relocate their corporate offices here. Or even, let's not forget about Chick-fil-A. They can bring their hate chicken corporate offices to Indiana. And again, like I said, put the in intolerant.
And Domino's Pizza, well, they're not Domino's Pizza anymore, just Domino's with their whole rebranding. It's another one. I mean, they're really, you know, we joke about it, but when you think about it, there actually is a huge, you know, corporate bigot market out there. Unfortunately, it's very sad to see. Here we are, the year 2015. You know, I don't think very many people 30 years ago would guess that America would become so regressive. We have, you know, LGBT community under attack from Republicans. We have women under attack from Republicans. Minorities, voting rights, you know, unarmed people being shot and killed by police in the middle of the street. I really feel like this country right now, we are going backwards quickly. You know, technology is advancing, but us as a human race, as an American people, we are going backwards as fast as we can, aren't we?
Absolutely. And it's important to even realize that, again, this is not just Indiana. When you talk about protections that exist for LGBTQ people across the country, one, there is no federal protections for LGBTQ discrimination. Currently, I think it's 19 states have protections, while two, which I think it's New York and Wisconsin, have it just for sexual orientation, but not gender identity. So that leaves 29 states where you literally can be fired just for being gay. 31 states where you can be fired for being transgendered. And again, no federal law protecting against LGBTQ discrimination. It's 2015, and that is flat out unacceptable.
And one of the things I love is one of the arguments that they use to sell ideas like this, you know, especially against same-sex marriage, is how are you going to tell your kids that one man is married to another man? And I have several children, and I can only imagine the conversation that I'm going to have with them to explain to them why two people over here have more rights than two people over there. I mean, that's something. How do you explain that to a child? How do you tell a kid that, oh, no, that person, they're not allowed to do a few things just because of who they're sexually attracted to or who they are as a person or what they believe? I mean, that you can't teach discrimination like that. I mean, I don't understand this at all, especially when it comes to children. You know, you can't tell a child that one person is more equal than another. You just can't.
What was hysterical is when this whole backlash against the Indiana bill came out, Governor Pence was on, I think he was on George Stephanopoulos' show this week, and he actually said that, well, you know, tolerance is a two-way street. I mean, like it's like, oh, no, we need to be tolerant against those who are intolerant, which, no, we don't. Again, you can be as bigoted in your heart as you want to be. That is America, but you actually can't take that hatred and that to a level where it's actual discrimination against people when it comes to goods and services, when it comes to businesses like that. I mean, again, the interesting side to me, again, is this, is how this actually did sort of backfire on Indiana and really hurt their economy. What I want to think about, you know, the job of us on the left going forward is how do we actually make this type of all of our types of justice that we're pursuing? How do we make those things bad for business? How do we make climate change bad for business? How do we make police brutality and the prison industrial complex bad for business? I mean, obviously, big picture, climate change is bad for business because, you know, once the society collapses, there are no businesses anymore. prison industrial complex, it's bad for business when so many people are actually behind bars and not actually contributing to society. But this is actually a fairly good model, specifically when it comes to Indiana, granted that they still need to actually put in protections for LGBTQ people. But this is an area where the backlash actually did have some results, where Indiana actually had to backtrack because people were so worked up about this. And so we need to work that area for all areas of justice.
We know that is one thing that I think the progressive movement as a whole is getting better at is unifying with each other, voting with our dollars. And right now, the best thing I can say to anyone, don't go to Indiana. Don't go to Arkansas. Don't go to Louisiana. Sorry, you got to avoid Mardi Gras, but things are about to get really bad. You know, Louisiana is about a 2.5 hour drive from where I am. And I can tell you, that bill is going to go over exactly as well as you would think if Bobby Jindal puts it in place in Louisiana. Matt Filipowicz, host of the Matthew Filipowicz Show, thank you for joining me. We'll definitely talk to you again. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Farron.